always remember. I want to speak to you this morning about hello, trouble. I woke up this morning. I go through my normal ritual, and before I go to bed at night, I always pray and ask the Lord to give me a good night of rest and raise me up in the morning and use me and make things where I can be something that's beneficial to Him. I woke up this morning. My allergies have been bothering me. Evidently, I slept with my mouth open all night. And that little uvula thing in your throat was all swollen up, sore. And you know what I said? Hello, trouble. Hello, trouble. How many of us understand that trouble is universal? It's something we all have. It's something we're all going to experience. As Christians, it's a valley that we're all going to walk through. So this morning, hello, trouble. Turn in your Bible to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 5. I'll read verses 3 through 5, reading in the English Standard Version. But we rejoice in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, endurance produces character, character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who's been given to us. I thought about the very words of Jesus in John chapter 16, when Jesus said Himself, in this world you will have trouble. Notice He didn't say might have trouble, or every now and then it may occur to you, or trouble may sometimes show up. No, Jesus said, in this world you will have trouble. Now those of us who have accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, there's something that we've learned. That along with the wonderful gift of salvation, we gained another friend. When we accepted Jesus Christ, another friend came along into our life, and this friend meets us, and he molds us, and he makes us, and he's become our new best friend. He helps us develop our character. He defines our circumstances. He determines challenges. He corrects us. He connects us. He confirms us. Sometimes he criticizes us, he confuses us, he's always cultivating us. And this friend has a lot of names. But the name that I know this friend does is trouble. Trouble. Believe it or not, trouble is my best friend. Next to Jesus Christ, trouble is something that God created to use in my life. And apart from Jesus, trouble will do more to determine my destiny than any association that I have. Now, I searched the World Wide Web when I was beginning to put this message together. I thought I needed to come up with someone that was really had credentials to speak to trouble. And I didn't do very well. And then even this morning in my office, Lily was in the office, and I had asked her a question about it. I was trying to think of people that could speak into us. I thought someone like Billy Graham or someone really powerful that I could pull out and that I could bring to you that could speak to us about trouble. I didn't come up with Billy Graham, but I did come up with somebody. Watch this.
Hello, trouble. Come on in. You talk about heartaches. Where in the world have you been?
Hadn't had no misery.
The misery since you've been gone.
Hello, trouble, 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 welcome home. Now there you go. Hello, trouble. Now, what's really fun about that is watching the young people. Because they're going, hey, that. I told Kathleen when we put that together, I said, you understand we're dating ourselves. You realize we're going way back. But you know what? Buck Owens said it best. As Christians, we ought to have a reaction to trouble. And our reaction should not be to run and hide. And it shouldn't be Poor, poor, pitiful me. And oh my goodness, why are these things happening in my life? Listen to me. As a Christian, we ought to say, hello, trouble. Come on. Hit me with your best shot. I want you to know this morning, Christianity is not just a life of wine and roses. It's not pie in the sky after you die. It's not life on Easy Street. Jesus told us, the world hates me, and the world is going to hate you. So how do we respond when trouble comes into our life? Do we avoid it? Do we avert it? Do we just deny it? But Paul said in this passage of Scripture, we ought to be happy to see trouble. We ought to welcome trouble. We ought to say, hello, trouble, come on in. We ought to look forward to his visit and rejoice when he arrives. Christians are never meant to cut and run when trouble arrives. Life is not all about the sweet by and by. Listen to me, it's about the nasty here and now. Buck Owens had it right. Listen to God's word, 2 Corinthians chapter 7. I'm greatly encouraged in all of our troubles. My joy knows no bounds. James chapter 1 and verse 2 says, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. We need to understand that God created trouble. And he crafts trouble. And not only did he create it, and not only does he craft it, he cares about our trouble. So this morning, I want to investigate the character of this new best friend that comes into our life every day, named trouble. First of all, I want you to understand the reality of trouble. In verse 3, we rejoice in our sufferings knowing, underline that word in your Bible, knowing that suffering produces endurance. That word knowing is a knowledge of reality. The reality that trouble indeed exist. God's word is a story about God's people, and all through God's word, from Genesis to Revelation, God's people are continually in trouble, continually having difficulties, continually caught up in heartaches. God's people experience trouble. And it's almost impossible to go through God's word and not see trouble. Moses had trouble. Joshua, Daniel, Jonah, David. What about our Savior, Jesus Christ? He knew trouble. And Paul outlines his trouble in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 when he said, three times I was beaten with rods, once I was stoned, three times I was shipwrecked, a night and a day I was adrift at sea, and then eventually he was beheaded in Rome. There's countless stories all through God's word of disciples. They were robbed, they were cold, they were thirsty, they were hungry, they were naked, they were abandoned. And there's a universal truth that rings true for everyone. We all have troubles. Every one of us have troubles. We have personal trouble, physical trouble, emotional trouble, financial trouble. We even have familial trouble. And Matthew chapter 5 says, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and the good. You know what that means? That means we all get it. It doesn't matter whether we're good or not. Doesn't matter whether we're bad. It's not what we deserve or what we don't deserve. God makes the rain to fall on the just and the unjust alike, and troubles are exactly the same way. And if you're sitting here this morning, and if you're breathing, let me promise you, you'll have troubles. You're going to have troubles and heartaches in your life. It's real. And remember, there's enough trouble to go around. Please don't create any more. Don't worry about finding trouble. Trouble's got a way of finding us. I heard about a patient that went to his doctor one day. The doctor ran a series and a battery of tests on him, and he came in and he had to have that talk with him that the doctor really does not enjoy having. He said, sir, I got to tell you, you're going to die. He said, I just don't know any other way to say it. You may have 6 months to live. I don't know if you'll even make it 6 months or not. The man looked at his doctor and he said, doc, what do I do? The doctor said, well, okay, here you go. Write this down. He said, I want you to marry a widow that has 10 kids. And then I want you to buy a hog farm. Then I want you to go home and I want you to turn your television on CNN and leave it on 24 hours a day. The man looked at him, he was confused. He said, doc, if I do that, am I going to live longer? Doctor said, probably not, but that's going to be the longest 6 months of your life. Amen? That's kind of like trouble. We need to remember that bad things happen to good people. There are examples in God's Word. Joseph suffered greatly in the Old Testament. Moses was obedient to God, and he never got to see the Promised Land. Daniel lived an exemplary life before he became a lion tamer. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were brave, yet they had a fiery experience. Trouble is a reality. So we need to understand the reality of trouble, but then let's look at the reason for trouble. It's a reality, and there's a reason. Look at verse 4. And endurance produces character. And character produces hope. Trouble invokes discipline in our life. And discipline is proof that God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit are active and that Jesus loves you. Hebrews chapter 12 says, the Lord disciplines who he loves. He chastises every son who he receives. It's for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons, for what son is there whom his father does not discipline? Has anyone here ever heard those words from your parents? This is going to hurt me more than it hurts you. Anybody ever heard that? Baloney! Till I became a parent. And then I understood exactly what my daddy meant every time he told me that. Well, it's not fun. It's not a great experience to have to discipline your children, the people that you love. But the point is, we love them enough to do it. We love them enough to save them from grief on down the road. We love them enough to teach them there's a right way and there's a wrong way to live in life. We love them enough to teach them that our relationships with others have value and have meaning. We correct our children because we love our children. There was a man one time that had his kids and they'd get in the car and they had a little yapping dog. And this dog liked to chase the car. And he would chase the car as they backed out of the driveway, and he had chased the car about halfway down the road. And one day, this little dog is running as hard as he can toward the car, and he gets right up next to the driver's side door, and the little boy's father slams on the brakes and slaps the door open. That dog runs into the door and falls over and rolls over and yapping, and went yapping back home. The little boy said, Daddy, that was mean. He said, no, son, that dog won't chase this car anymore. You know, that dog needs to understand that the car is dangerous. The road is dangerous. And when he was able to take that isolated moment and apply it and see that it hurts to chase the car, then a lesson was learned. Proverbs chapter 3 says, my son, do not despise the Lord's discipline, or be weary of his reproof. For the Lord reproves those he loves as a father the son. Trouble invokes discipline, but trouble inspires discourse. You know what it does? It makes us talk to each other. One of the things that we're suffering from is a lack of communication. And it really exists in Christianity. It really exists among Christians. We ought to be close. We ought to be able to share our burdens one to the other. Amen? We ought to be able to talk to each other and tell each other honestly how we feel, what's going on in our life, what's hurting us, what situations and circumstances, what burdens are coming to bear on us. We ought to have discourse, and there's nothing like trouble to make us finally come together and say, you know what? I'm hurting. I need help. I don't understand something. I'm troubled. Yesterday, I got a text from a young lady, and as a matter of fact, it was a series of texts. And those texts came because she was hurting. She was in pain. And finally, she was reaching out, and in the text, she even said, I have trouble reaching out. I'm so glad she reached out. There needs to be discourse among Christians. We need to come together and love each other, and it helps us minister to others. And listen, because God allows trouble in my life, I can identify with you. I can better understand when you come to me and say, I'm hurting. I can better understand your situation and your circumstance when you share the details of your life with me. And immediately I can go back to that time when I had that trouble in my life. God prepares us to minister to others. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 says, Blessed be God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jump down to verse 4. So that we may be able to comfort those who are in affliction. Our experience is a sign of hope. Recovery programs share what they call experience, strength, and hope. Bill Wilson, the founder of Alcoholics Anonymous, wrote, We'll see how our troubles and failures can benefit others. Think about it. We learn from our failures. I don't know about you, but I've learned the most in my life from my absolute defeat. Every time that I'm in victory, every time things are going good in my life, I'm too busy being happy on top of the mountain. But you let the hurt come, you let the trouble come, you let the trials and the tribulations come, and I'm paying attention. I'm looking for an answer. Don't scuttle your troubles. Share them. Share them one with the other. Trouble invokes discipline. It inspires discourse, but listen, trouble induces our devotion. It draws us closer to God. In our text, verse 3 through 5, we rejoice in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, endurance produces character, character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our heart. We need to understand that trouble is not an event. Trouble is a process. And it's a process by which we learn. We get our word trouble from a Greek word that's tribulum. A tribulum is a heavy timber. It's full of spikes, and it was used to thrash grain. It would separate the wheat from the chaff. You know, God's process, His tribulum in our life, is to separate the wheat from the chaff. It's to serve as that tribulum in our life that removes impurities and restores imperfections. And in Psalm chapter 119, it says, Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. How do we learn to keep His word? When we go through trouble and we learn it's true. And we understand He is always there. And we understand that He really does care. And we know that we know that we know in our heart that there are answers that only come from Him, and they only come through His bountiful, wonderful love. Hello, trouble. Amen. That's how we learn. Listen to me this morning. God is more concerned with our growth than He is our comfort. And God loves you and me so much that He refuses to let us stay like we are. God uses tribulation. It's a fine finishing tool. And He uses it to measure our love and to manifest His love. So listen to me this morning. This is how trouble works. Trouble magnifies my weakness. Boy, have I learned how weak I am. As a human being, how weak and frail that I am. Pastor John Piper brought a message one time, and he said, the difference in Uncle Sam and in Jesus is that Uncle Sam will only enlist you if you're healthy. But Jesus will enlist us when we're sick. Amen. I'm so glad that Jesus enlists me when I'm sick. The gospel is not a help wanted ad. It's a help available. Help available ad. God is in the helping business. And God's not looking for people to work for Him. God's looking for people to work through Him. Tribulation magnifies my weakness. But trouble also maximizes God's work. Paul said in 2 Corinthians, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. And then jump down to verse 10. I am content with weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I'm strong. Tribulation magnifies my weakness. It maximizes God's work. And tribulation motivates God's will. Some of the greatest moves of God have come in the middle of trouble. John Bunyan was in the Bedford jail when he wrote probably the greatest piece of Christian fiction that was ever written, Pilgrim's Progress. Fanny Crosby was blind and wrote over 8,000 hymns, including Blessed Assurance, To God Be the Glory. Charles Weigel lost his entire family in a tragic accident, but he wrote the song, No One Ever Cared For Me Like Jesus. Listen, loved ones, our life are like the metal in a blacksmith shop. The blacksmith will take a piece of metal and he'll put it in the fire, and he puts it in the fire long enough for it to become pliable, for it to become bendable. And then he'll take a vise and he'll shape the bendable metal. And then he takes that metal and he puts it in the water to harden the metal. Pay attention. Listen. Metal that's not pliable, metal that's not bendable, metal that's not hardened is thrown away on the scrap heap. We got a reality of trouble. We've got a reason for trouble. But now here's where I want to leave you this morning. We should have a response to trouble. Verse 3, we rejoice. We rejoice. We rejoice in our trouble. We rejoice in our heartaches. We rejoice in our tribulations. Why? Wow, it's an opportunity for God. It's an opportunity to do for us what He longs to do for us, because He loves us intently. And every problem I go through, every time I suffer, no matter what the heartache is, it's an opportunity for my God to show up. It's an opportunity for my God to grow me, to pick me up, to teach me things that I need to know. We need to embrace trouble, we need to employ it, and we need to be empowered by it. And verse 3 says, rejoice. Now here's some biblical suggestions on how to respond to trouble. The first thing we need to do in trouble is turn to the truth. And the truth is right here. Right here in God's Word. This is the truth according to God Almighty, the Creator of the universe. And it gives us everything we need to overpower and overachieve and overcome. And there's no substitute for God's Word in a time of trouble. We need to turn to the truth. But listen, secondly, we need to thrive on thanksgiving. Times of trouble are times to remember what God has done for us, how He's always seen us through, how He's supplied our needs when we didn't know where it was going to come from, how He's taken care of our children and our loved ones when they were out of our care and we didn't know what was going to happen. It's always an opportunity to give God thanks. We need to turn to truth and we need to thrive on thanksgiving. When we have trouble in our life, it's a time for transformation, dedication, consecration, edification. And we capture those moments, listen, in satisfaction and consideration. We thank God continually for His method and for His motive. 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, "Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus." All circumstances. Look up that word "all" in the dictionary. It means wholly, completely, totally. And I'm not supposed to do it just when I feel like it and just when it's convenient or not because I feel like I deserve it. I give thanks in all things. I thank Him for the good. I thank Him for the bad. I thank Him for the ugly. There's a lady named Corrie Ten Boom. Brother George knows who Corrie Ten Boom is. I'm sure some of the others do. She was a Dutch woman during World War II. And she would help the Jews that were being persecuted to be hidden and sometimes to escape. The Nazis captured her and put her in the concentration camp. They also captured her sister, Betsy. And Corrie and Betsy were placed in a stalag that was next to a torture chamber. All day, all night, they would hear people crying, screaming in pain, that were being tortured beyond what the mind could even imagine. And Corrie had memorized God's Word. And she had a group of ladies that were in the barracks with her. And Corrie and Betsy would bring the ladies around. And Corrie would recite God's Word and teach the ladies to have faith, to have hope, and to have strength. They didn't have any beds to sleep on. The Nazis only gave them hay and straw. And here's the thing about the hay. The ladies would lay on the hay and be covered in fleas. The infestation of fleas was so heavy. Imagine laying there day after day after night being covered in fleas. Biting you, filling your hair, filling your eyes. The misery of the fleas. And one day, Corrie Ten Boom was teaching the ladies in the barracks and teaching them to love God and teaching them to have joy in their suffering and teaching them to understand that it was all part of God's will. And one of the prisoners stood up and said, "Listen, I may thank God for being a wonderful God, but I will never thank Him for these fleas." Corrie Ten Boom looked at her. She said, "Do you understand that we're able to come together and we're able to have Bible study and we're able to pray together because the guards leave us alone because they don't want any part of the fleas? Thank God for the fleas. Amen." Thank God for the fleas. Listen to me. No matter what's going on in your life, no matter what fleas are infesting you, the troubles and the trials and the tribulations, thank God for your fleas. God sent those fleas. He's got a reason for those fleas. He's going to work through the fleas in your life. And when life covers you in fleas of pain and peril and persecution and pettiness and pestilence, thank God. Thank God for your fleas. You can curse the fleas of life, or you can cultivate the fleas of life with joy, with expectation. Paul said in Philippians chapter 4, I have learned. There it is again. It's a process. Process. It's not an event. Listen, we don't just get this stuff. We have to live it. When we live it, we learn it. Paul said, I have learned whatever situation I am in, therein to be content. I know how to be brought low. I know how to abound in any and every circumstance. I've learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Knowing that God has a promise and a purpose and a plan, I need to thrive on thanksgiving. And listen, then I need to target His triumph. When Jesus hung on the cross of Calvary, those words at the end, He said, it is finished. It's His triumph. There's nothing we can go through that Jesus doesn't understand. There's no problem or trial or tribulation in life that we'll ever have that Jesus hasn't walked that road, and He has victory over every problem in my life. I need to live by faith, not leave in fright. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, be watchful, stand firm in faith. And for us guys, the scripture says, act like men. Be strong. John chapter 16, I have overcome the world. Jesus is our triumph. He triumphs over sin and sickness and superstition, darkness and death and decay, heartache, hurt, heaviness. Jesus makes the fleas flee. Amen. John chapter 16, in the world you will have trouble, tribulation. Be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. We need to turn to the truth, thrive on thanksgiving, target His triumph, but listen, we need to touch His throne. Amen. Times of trouble is when we need to go to Jesus. Times of trial and tribulation and heartache is when we ought to cling to Him, when we ought to approach His throne. Talk to Him. Edmund Lorenz wrote a song, are you weary? Are you heavy-hearted? Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. We need to take it to Jesus, tell it to Jesus, and trust it to Jesus. And understand that our burdens need to become bridges. They're bridges for others to see God's power, God's purpose, God's promise. Human beings, we are so selfish. We're such selfish people. We think about ourselves all the time. Listen to me. God allows trouble in our life because He loves George and because He loves Kathleen, because He loves Elizabeth. And He wants others to be able to see in our trouble that He's alive and that He's real. And when others get to look at our life and see our troubles and our trials and our difficulties, and they see how God brings them through, it gives them hope. It gives them strength. It's God's tool to use. Thank God for the fleas. Amen? It's not all about me. Not all about my wonderful life. Not all about my comfort, my safety. Our burdens are bridges. There was a biologist one time that was studying ants. And he was watching one particular ant one day. And the ant had picked up a little piece of straw. But the straw was at least 5 times bigger than the ant. But that ant had that piece of straw. And he was trying to carry it to a location. He would drag and he would push. And it was almost more than he could pick it up. And he'd carry a little bit and put it down. And then he came to a big crack in the concrete. And this biologist said, I watched the ant. And it was almost like the ant stopped for a moment and started thinking. Now what am I going to do? And then the ant took the piece of straw and laid it across the crack and went across the piece of straw to the other side. You know what that ant had done? He had taken burdens and built bridges. You and I need to take our burdens and build bridges. And those bridges are not just about us. They're about others. So that others can see that when burdens hit our life, we built bridges. Amen? For others. The bridges of life have a foundation of burdens. Don't let your burdens keep you bound. Turn your burdens into bridges. Turn your trials into triumphs. Turn your problems into possibilities. Hello, trouble. Amen? Every Christian, every child of God, this ought to be your response toward trouble. Hello, trouble. Come on in. Hit me with your best shot. See what you got. And at the end, I'll show you how to turn burdens into bridges. It's a reality. There's a reason for it. And we have a response to it. John chapter 16. Now you have sorrow, but I will see you again. And your heart will rejoice, and nobody will ever take your joy. Let's stand together. Heavenly Father, thank you for trouble. Thank you, Lord, that you created a mechanism for us to learn, for us to grow, for us to be useful to you, and for us to be useful to others. Father, I absolutely know there are people listening this morning that are hurting. And their hearts are breaking. And there's trouble in their life. They don't know what to do. Father, I ask you in Jesus' name that you would just sink your word into their heart and into their mind. That you love them. And because you love them, you want to take their burdens and you want to build bridges. Bridges of happiness. Bridges of peace. Bridges of solitude. Bridges of comfort. Father, move and do what only you can do. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.